this morning, God. Oh, we thank you, Jesus, for your ever blessing, God.
good time to worship Him today. Oh, worship is between you and Him. Nobody else, just you and Him. Oh, we came to worship Him. Let's do that right now, all over this place. Lift your voices, open your hearts, open your minds. Say, God, you are holy. You are holy. You are holy. You are holy. Yes, Lord. Worship Him. Thank Him today. Thank Him today for the privilege we have together to worship Him. Praise God. Praise God. Oh, aren't you glad you know this wonderful truth today? A lot of people don't have this like we have it. So we ought to thank Him for it. We ought to thank Him for it. A lot of people don't have this privilege that we have. So we ought to thank Him for it. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Amen, amen, amen. Usher's coming to help us this morning. Usher's coming to help us this morning to give is unto the Lord. Next Sunday morning, don't forget this. Don't forget this. Next Sunday morning, that will be right after church service. There'll be a soup potluck dinner. Soup potluck dinner. And so bring your selves with you, bring some crackers and cornbread or desserts, and let's have a good time of fellowship. In fact, if you can bring cornbread or crackers or desserts, why don't you sign that up out there at the vestibule desk so they'll know how to plan. God bless you. Bring your offering to the Lord.
Hallelujah. give the Lord praise today. Oh, that's right. Go ahead and praise Him. He's worthy to be praised. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. That's right. Let's worship Him. Let's praise His name today. He's worthy. Praise His name today. He's worthy of the highest praise. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated for a few moments. So good to see all of you in the house of the Lord today. We're so thankful for His goodness and mercy and grace, and able to look here and see some folks that have battled sickness and other things. And we're glad that you are doing better, and you've been in our prayers, and thank the Lord for bringing you through. And all of our guests, we're so glad you're here. Can you welcome our guests to Bethlehem Church today? Amen. Thank you for being here. And we're thankful. We're thankful for what the Lord is doing. And we have a lot of announcements, a lot of things. It's the holiday season, so there's a lot of things that are going on. Our young ministers class today is at 4:15. So those of you that are involved in that, I got a special treat for you. Bishop Wilson's going to teach. So you can meet at 4:15 like we normally do. And if you're interested, if you haven't come to that and you're interested in it, then we will be there at 4:15, either in my office or we'll go from there if the room gets too crowded. I hope it does. But looking forward to that tonight. Brother Adrian Sanford, full-time evangelist out of our church, is going to be here and preaching. Him and his wife, his sister Courtney, will be singing, I think, and just going to have a good time in the Holy Ghost tonight. Looking forward to a great time. Tomorrow night is our district minister's banquet. And those of you that have signed up for that, the meal is at Blue Mountain College, the dining room at 7 o'clock. You can get there at 6:30. Those of you from our church that are helping serve and park cars, you need to see me. We need to be there before that. So if you'll see me, we'll make sure that we got the arrangements made for that. Of course, Tuesday is our university outreach. Wednesday night, everybody say Wednesday night. Wednesday night, we're having our church midweek service in the new building, in the gym and dining room over there. There is a BCS concert and a full holiday meal. The cost for the meal is only $5 to cover the cost. And we hope that you'll all be involved and come out. Our students have tickets that they can sell you, so that they know exactly how much food to fix. But we're going to have a good time. Bring somebody with you. Bring a guest with you. And let's have a good time enjoying fellowship with the Lord's banquet, with the Lord's people at the meal. I got my announcements mixed up there. Today, I hope, is the Lord's spiritual banquet. We have our Christmas meal Thursday night. So those of you with our BCS staff, church staff, remember that. Saturday at 10 o'clock is practice. All the parents, please listen up. It's the kids program practice, 10 o'clock here at the church on Saturday morning. The rehearsal next Sunday morning is the kids Christmas program. Hope you'll bring some folks out. It's always a good time. Sunday night is the adult program. That's next Sunday night. And as Brother Wilson mentioned, in between, after the morning service, is the soup meal. That's free. Anybody that's here is welcome to go down and enjoy fellowship. Amen. Then the college and career young couples Christmas get-together is the following Wednesday. Sunday the 18th is the meal for all of our seniors, our Christmas meal for the seniors. That'll be after the morning service. And here, everybody pay attention. Christmas is on a Sunday. We're going to do our service, our Christmas service, on Friday the 23rd at 7 o'clock. We're going to do it a Friday night service, and then you'll have your Saturday and Sunday with your family, Christmas Eve and Christmas with your family. But our service will be Friday night, and then after that, our regular schedule will be in place. So remember that. It's a lot of announcements, isn't it? It'd be nice if I was done, but I'm not. So remember our P52, which is our weekly Bible study, or daily Bible study. You can get that in your email every day. And this upcoming week is the book of Acts, chapter number 19. You'll enjoy that. And that you can get those by email if you turn your email in to the ladies at the information booth or to me personally. We'll make sure we get you on there. There's a embroidery class. It says little girls. I guess if little boys want to do it, they can. But it says little girls embroidery class. There's going to be a sign-up sheet tonight. And if little girls are interested, or big girls, I suppose, or anybody would be interested in learning embroidery, you can sign up for that. And you'll have a good time. And also, we are preparing a class. And we've announced it a couple of times. And it is on human trafficking. And, you know, when the class was brought to me, the idea was brought to me in my mind, I thought, well, you know, that's not an issue. That's not an issue around here. That's not something we need to worry about. That's something that happens in big cities and foreign countries. Did you know that Marshall County has a task force for human trafficking because it's a problem right here in our area? And right here in our area, there were 16 girls that had been held captive within 40 miles of here. Arrest was made. Those girls are being used for terrible things. It's an issue right here in our own area. And any of you parents, grandparents that want to get more information, you can sign up. There will be a sign-up sheet tonight. And that is something that for your children and grandchildren's sake, it may be a very good thing for you to do. When we hear the term human trafficking, we don't think we don't really know exactly what it is, first of all, and we don't think it's an issue here in our area. So we want to do that as a service to help you be aware, and to any of your friends and neighbors that might be interested. If there's a task force in our county for it, there's a reason there's a task force for it, okay? So there'll be a sign-up sheet tonight. Can everybody say amen? Thank the Lord. I am excited about what God is doing, and I'm glad to be in an apostolic church. Amen. Stand with me, if you will, where we preach and teach the apostles' doctrine, repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Amen. We have a lot of people that are out of town, and a lot of people that are sick, and if you'll just be in prayer, that sickness is going around. That hopefully wasn't part of it. Hopefully, my mouth got dry from talking so much. That's hopefully all that was. But be in prayer for your church family. 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. 2 Corinthians chapter number 12 and verse number 9. It's hard to believe with all those announcements, I feel like I've forgotten something. But that's me knowing me, I guess. 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. I made myself a note to announce that I put NY so that I would announce our New Year's Sunday is going to be the same schedule as always. And when I looked at my notes, I thought, why did I put New York on my list? That's how bad my memory is. So, amen, we're not all going to New York as far as I know. 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, if you found it, say amen. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength, this is the Lord talking, my strength is made perfect in weakness. Now Paul says, most gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Most gladly, therefore, will I, everybody say I, rather glory in my infirmities, everybody say my, that the power of Christ may rest upon me, everybody say me, I, my, and me. I'm going to preach for a while this morning, someone like me, someone like me. Lord, I thank you, God, for your people, for your church. God, this is your church, and these are your people that you have loved with an everlasting love. God, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would bless your people with strength and healing and deliverance and grace and glory. Anoint me to preach your word, Lord. Let the anointing of the Holy Ghost move in this place, God, by the authority of your word and by the power of your name. God, I pray that the anointing of your spirit would move in a mighty way. Let the power of the Holy Ghost rest on each one and have and accomplish your purpose in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Give the Lord a praise as you're being seated. God bless you. Amen. I did forget one thing. We'll have prayer in the sanctuary tonight before service. The Bible is a story of great heroes. It's a story of champions. My earliest memories center around church. I remember the church that I grew up in. It seemed like a huge building. I went back last year. It's for sale. It's an old, old building. It's for sale. And I looked through the windows and I thought, man, I didn't realize that was such a small building. But it had hardwood floors. And my earliest memories are me falling asleep and laying under the pews and hearing people worship and shout on those hardwood floors. My memories center around church. My childhood was filled with church. And the epic stories that I learned about Bible characters, larger than life people. My mind pictures Jacob wrestling with the angel. And I've heard the story so much that I can almost see the perspiration on his forehead. The rippling muscles of Samson as he wields the donkey's jawbone, heaps of Philistines on his right and on his left. Almost as if I was there, I've seen it in my mind's eye so many times. In the pages of this leather-bound book, we think of champions of faith that have influenced whole societies and they have since the earliest civilizations. Abraham and Isaac, Moses and Joshua overcoming enemies and kingdoms and trials, leading Israel to their promise. Deborah and Gideon and Samson and Samuel, all showing the majesty of God's power throughout their time. Elijah and Elisha, David, the kings, the prophets of the Lord, walking in the power of the living God to show us how amazing that God is. As the Old Testament gives way to the New Testament, the names change, but the feats of faith are no less stirring. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John writing in the Gospels, Peter, Paul, and Silas, Barnabas, Philip, and on the list goes, each of them revealing the victorious power of our God. Time doesn't permit me to really even mention much about Noah and Sarah and Rebecca and Rachel and Hannah and Josiah and Timothy and Ezekiel and Jeremiah, Aaron or Miriam or any of the lesser known heroes of the Bible. The scriptures from Genesis to Revelation are filled with champions, winners, heroes, conquerors, to the degree that if we are not careful, we are tempted to believe that the Bible is full of supermen and wonder women. What could someone like me possibly have in common with someone in the Bible? It would seem that the majestic God of the universe would be the God of the hero, the God of the champion, the God of the successful, the awesome, the amazing. Why would the God of the giant killer care about someone like me? I've never killed a lion, a bear, or a giant like David did. I never have built an ark like Noah. I've never parted the sea like Moses or brought down walls like Joshua. I've never killed Philistines like Samson or walked through prison doors like Simon Peter or seen a resurrection like Paul. What could a God like that see in someone like me, someone like you? We have issues. We have problems. We have trials and tests and tribulations. Maybe you don't, but I do. We have sickness and frustrations and disappointments. I don't always feel like I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Sometimes I feel like I can't do anything right. I know I'm probably the only one. I'll be honest with you, I feel like a failure more than I feel like a champion. I feel like a loser more than I feel victorious. I feel frustration more than I feel faith, usually. I feel weak more than I feel strong. The God of David wouldn't be interested in my daily struggles. He worries about giant killers and lion killers. The God of Abraham would be so disgusted by my problems that he wouldn't give me the time of day. I'm not the father of faith. Why would he give me a second thought? And so we carry our shame and our burdens and our weakness and our sin, thinking that God is so holy and wonderful and powerful, mighty and miraculous, and he is all that. He is astounding and amazing and marvelous and sublime and superb and magnificent. He's all of that. He's beautiful and splendid and glorious. And someone like him, he's all that and a whole lot more. Why would someone like that care about someone like me? He is an awesome God. So why would he be worried with someone that's not awesome? He is a great God. So why would he care about someone like me that isn't great? He is a glorious God, but I'm inglorious. He's magnificent, but I have problems. He's amazing, but I have issues. So why would a God like that care about someone like me? But may I tell you that the accusation that was brought against Jesus Christ was not that he was the friend of the awesome, the friend of the amazing, the friend of the hero, the friend of the champion. The accusation brought against Jesus was he's a friend of sinners. It was the distressed prophet Jeremiah. Now look, I'm almost done preaching. I know you don't believe me, but I really am. So if you're going to get on board, you got to get on board now. It was the distressed prophet Jeremiah that cried in exasperation, "Is there no balm in Gilead?" And then he said, "Is there no physician there? Is there no doctor that can heal the sick and the hurting, the wounded and the bleeding? Is there no physician there that can take care of somebody that's been hurt and abused by life, that's been hurt and mistreated by somebody else?" It was 700 years after that. Actually, 696 years later, that Jesus Christ stepped on the scene and he said, "They that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick." Jesus answered Jeremiah's question. There is a physician, but he didn't come to the perfect. He didn't come to the whole. He didn't come to the hero or the victor or the conqueror or the champion. He came to the sick, to the weary, or the sinner. So can I say it like this? He came for someone like me. Oh God. Hallelujah. He proclaimed, man, I feel the Holy Ghost up here right now. He proclaimed that he came to the lost sheep, not to the perfect one that knew everything, not to the one that was right exactly where they ought to be, but he came to the lost sheep that was outside the fold, that was away, that was lonely, that was in danger, that was in peril, not to the perfect, not to the one without blemish. He came for someone like me. Jesus Christ was anointed of the Spirit of the Lord. His works and his words were evidence of the power of the Spirit of the Lord upon him. He walked on water. He cured the sick. He raised the dead. He cast out devils. He healed diseases. Everywhere he went, there were power, signs, wonders, all by the work of the Spirit of the Almighty God. But why was he so imparted by the Holy Ghost? Why was he so blessed by the Spirit? He said in Luke chapter 4 and verse number 18, in your Bible, it's in red. Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And we already knew that. We knew the Spirit was upon him when angels started singing. We knew the Spirit was upon him when shepherds came and said, peace on earth. We knew he was anointed of the Spirit when the wise men came and the stars settled over the manger. We knew that he was full of the Spirit when he walked on water and turned water into wine, opened blind eyes, made the lame walk, made the blind see, made the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak. We knew he was anointed of the Spirit when he cast out devils and he raised up the sick and the diseased and the dying and the dead. We knew he was full of the Spirit when he fed 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish and went walking on the white capped waves of the sea. We knew he was full of the Spirit, but why was he full of the Spirit? Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Not because I've been sent to the perfect. Not because I've been sent to the one that has no issues, but the Spirit is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. The good news, not to the perfect, but to the poor, to someone like me. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, not the one with no issues, not the one that can lay their head down at night and everything in their life is perfect and rosy with no cares and no trials. But he sent him, he was anointed for the reason. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, not because I've come to the perfect, but because I have come to heal the brokenhearted. In other words, he came for someone like me. He came to preach deliverance to the captive, not the free, not the victorious, not the one that's got it all together, not the one with the perfect life, not the one with no issues and no trials and no tests, but to preach deliverance to the captive. He came to someone like me. The recovering of sight to the blind. Not the one that sees everything clearly. Not the one that has everything together. But he came for someone like me. To set at liberty those that are bruised. Can I say it just as plain as I can? He was anointed for someone like me. Paul got a revelation of God's grace. It's easy to give grace to people who don't do anything wrong. It's easy to have grace on people whose lives are all together and everything's perfect and they never do anything wrong and everything in their life is, you know, they got the family of 4.2 with a dog and a nice car and everything perfect. It's easy to have mercy and grace on somebody that doesn't have any issues, but Paul got a revelation. He said that the Lord told him, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. You want a strong God? God's strength is made perfect when we're weak. And then Paul said, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, in my weakness, in my sickness, in my trial. If you read this passage, for the one of time, I didn't go into it too deep, but Paul was complaining to God because he had a thorn in his flesh. Now, there's some speculation on exactly what that means. Some people believe that Paul was blind and, or at least had very poor eyesight. And that he was praying that God would heal him. And he was frustrated because he healed other people. Paul would pray and other people would get healed. But yet he was still blind. And he was frustrated because everybody else seemed to be getting their miracle. And everybody else seemed to be getting their supernatural impartation. And everybody else was getting their breakthrough. And here he was struggling just to even be able to see, to the point that he had to have other people write for him. Had other people do stuff for him because he couldn't do it himself. And he was frustrated because other people seemed to be getting their breakthrough and other people seemed to be getting their miracle. And here I am. I'm struggling too, God. I'm trying to get what I need from you too, and everybody else is getting what they need. So he is frustrated and he's tired and he's weary because because he's not getting what he wants, and he's not getting there as quick as he wants, and he's frustrated, and he's complaining to God, and he's saying, God, I prayed 3 times that the thorn in my flesh would be taken away, and every time I pray, it's still there, and I'm tired, and I'm frustrated, and I'm weary, because it seems like I'm not getting anywhere. And God said, my strength is made perfect in weakness. So Paul said, if that's the case, then God, I'm just going to be happy with whatever my situation is. I'll just glory in my infirmities. Oh God, you know why? He said, because, look what he said. Because the Lord said, he said, here's what it is. Oh God, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Can I tell somebody today that you're never close, you're never closer to the power of God than you are when you're weak, when you're facing trials, when you're going through situations and you feel like God is so far away, like Paul did. He said, you know what? When I thought God was far away, that's when he was the closest. When I thought that I was as furthest away from God, that's when the power of Christ was on me the most. If you want to feel like you're truly close to God, then you have to understand that God is with you. Listen to this verse, Psalms 34 and 17. This is the last verse we're going to go to today. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart. I've had my heart broken a few times. I've been frustrated, disappointed, let down, hurt, mad, angry. I was talking with Brother Carpenter the other day about a situation we've been having to deal with, and I told him the John in me wants to say this, this, and this. The John in me wants to just tell him this, this, and this. I said, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to let the Lord work it out and let God deal with it, and he'll fix it. But the me in me, I've had to deal with me a few times. Amen. And the psalmist said, the Lord is nigh unto them, or close to them, that are of a broken heart. The closest you can ever get to God is when you're the most broken. The problem is that the furthest you feel from God is usually when you're the most broken. You ever been going through situations in life and you feel like God is so far away? All you can think about are the problems that you're dealing with, the issues that you're dealing with, and it feels like God is so far away. That's when you have to take the Bible as the true word of God. And the Lord, the Bible said, the Lord is nigh them that are of a broken heart. You're never closer to God than when your heart is broken. He's next to you. That's what that word nigh, it means next to, allied with, close to those that are broken. The word broken means crushed. The Hebrew word means a heart that is about to burst. He said the Lord is allied close and next to those whose heart is crushed and about to burst. In other words, he's close to someone like me. Oh, God. Man, I wish I was, Brother Wilson, I wish I was a giant killer. I wish I was like David and I could kill lions and bears and giants. Man, I wish I was a giant killer. I got on, and I wish I'd have brought it in here. I was going to preach about Samson one time, and so I went on Google, and I Googled jawbone of an ass. And I don't recommend that for underage people. But I found a website that was for $45 I bought a donkey's jawbone, and I got it in my office, and it's sitting on top of my bookshelf in there. And every so often I'll look up and I'll get it. And some of the little boys in the church, they're fascinated. I got dinosaur teeth, and I got a sword, and I got a donkey's jawbone, and they like to go in there and like to mess with all the stuff, and they like to get the dinosaur teeth and hold them, and they like to get that donkey's jawbone down. And I always get it down, and I hand it to the little boys, because in my mind, it wasn't what it is. You know, in my mind, I saw it different. And so I got this, and it's heavy. And I'm thinking, man, just to swing the thing a thousand times, if he killed a thousand Philistines in one shot, he had to be a man just to swing it that many times. And I hold that thing and I think, man, I look at it, I think, man, I wish I was like Samson. I mean, I look like him, but I'm not like him. I know that comes as a surprise. The reason I'm not is because I opened my iPad and had a napkin from eating, not from working out. But I think, man, I wish I was like Samson. I wish I could do that. Man, I wish I was strong like that. And I'll hold that donkey's jaw and I'll be like, wow, I'm going to have them lined up today wanting to see that thing probably. And But I really do wish that I could be like Abraham. I wish my faith was such that I could just trust God. I wish I could be like Moses, that could walk up to a Red Sea and say, no problem, and hold the rod out over and watch the Red Sea roll back. I wish I could be like Daniel, who'd say, okay, go ahead and throw me in jail. It'll be all right. Or like the three Hebrew children. All right, you can throw me in the fiery furnace, but I'm not going to bow. I wish I was like that. I wish I was like Simon Peter, who would step out of the boat onto the water. Or I wish I was like Paul, that said, okay, if you got to throw me in jail, that's fine, but I'm not going to quit preaching this message. I wish that I was like the heroes of the Bible, because when I read the Bible, I think that's who God comes to. But then when I look closer, I realize that really he came to someone just like me. Oh, thank God. Thank God that he's not so busy with the heroes that he's still got time for someone like me. Thank God that he's not so busy with the conqueror that he still has time for somebody like me who wonders how it's going to work out. I wonder how I'm going to get through. I wonder how I'll make it through the day. I wonder how I'm going to get through my trial. I wonder how I'm going to survive what's coming my way. Thank God that he still has time for someone like me. God, that's why I'm here today. Not because I'm perfect, but because I need you. That's why I'm here, not because I got it all together, but because I need you, God. That's why I'm worshiping right now. Not because I've got no problems, but because I'm so overcome with them, I don't know what to do next. I need you, God, to love someone like me. Oh, I wish somebody like me would just say, God, that's why I'm calling on you right now. Not because I'm David or Abraham or Joshua. Not because I'm Daniel. Not because I'm Samuel. But God, I'm someone that just needs you today. Because I've got frustrations and issues and trials. And thank you, God, because you came to church today for someone like me. Oh, if you're like me, you ought to just lift your hands all over this place. If you're someone like me, you ought to just lift your hands all over this place. Someone just thank you, Lord. 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 I wonder if there's anybody here like me. You're not a lion killer. You're not a giant killer. You don't know what you'd do if faced with a fiery furnace or a lion's den. Maybe you're just somebody like me and you're not quite sure how some things are going to make it. And you're not quite sure how it's going to work out. And you're just somebody like me. I'm going to tell you, these altars weren't built for David's and Joshua's and Moses' and Noah's and Rebecca's and Hannah's. These altars were built for somebody like me and somebody like you and somebody that's got worries and trials and cares and circumstances and situations. This altar is built for somebody like me and somebody like you. And the good news is that the God that we serve today is not only the God of the hero and the God of the conqueror, but he's the God that says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. Come, all you that are tired and weary and carrying a whole bunch of burdens. Come, all you that are carrying stuff that you don't know how long you can carry it. And you're about to be crushed under the load of your trials and tests and circumstances." He said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He is here for somebody just like me. Oh, that's right. Go ahead and worship the Lord. Go ahead and worship the Lord. Go ahead and cry out to him. You ought to just open up your heart right now to the presence of the Lord.
You
got time to let the